Now you will allow me to shift to English to welcome Peter Spiegel. And you will also allow me to disclose that when I contacted him to more or less explain the rules of the game, which I hope he will keep, meaning the 8 minutes and all that crap, I told him that I look forward to his intervention because, in fact, however high the profile of the high and mighty of Europe, such as Dr. Schäuble, or of the exiles such as Mrs. Lagarde, the rules of the effective game are called by the international media. So he has the floor.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I will try to keep to that guidance. First of all, I also want to thank the organizers for including me. I, as many of you know, come to Greece quite often, but I don't make it out of Athens all that frequently. So it's wonderful to be up here in Delphi. And walking here this morning, I saw this giant yellow circle in the sky, which we don't have in Belgium. And I was informed that that's in Greece we call that the sun. So it's lovely to be here and get some vitamin D. I'm going to be slightly mischievous in my remarks today because when I was contacted about what they wanted me to talk about, it was this issue that's in the program about our economy is affected by having too much debt. And I don't want to answer that question. I don't want to answer that question for three reasons. First of all, I'm not an economist. I'm a dilettante, and I'm sharing the panel here with some of the greatest economic minds here in Greece. And there's one sitting right across from me in the front row, a former prime minister and central banker. So who am I to say whether this is true or not? But secondly, and more importantly, what is too much debt? It is something that I've struggled with as I've covered this crisis for the last 6 years. As Mr. Hardoubalos said in his presentation, pick your forecast. We're at about 178% of GDP when you talk about Greek debt. It sounds very high. Again, as Mr. Hardoubalos said, it's the highest in the Eurozone. And yet, if you look across to Japan, their debt-to-GDP ratio is 230%. And yet, I checked the bond market just before I left for Delphi, and Japan's 10-year, they are able to borrow at less than 1%. For some reason, the markets have decided that a high debt-to-GDP ratio in Japan is sustainable, and Greece is not. The other example I want to get to, and I want to talk at more length later in my remarks, is the famous meeting that happened in November 2012, where the current debate on debt relief for Greece began. At that time, as the Prime Minister mentioned yesterday, there was a decision that Greece had to get to 120% of debt to GDP by 2020. Where did that number come from? It was made up. It was a number picked out of the sky. And I know this for a fact because I talked to people, where did you get 120% debt to GDP ratio? They said to me, that's where Italy is right now, and we can't tell anyone that Italy is unsustainable, so let's use Italy and we'll just use that number. Well, Italy is now at 133% debt to GDP ratio, so by that measure, Italy's debt is unsustainable. So these numbers, frankly, I think mean very little. The last point I will make is the point that Mr. Theokarakis made, which is, over the last 6 years, I have tried to read literature on this. And I reminded of the famous quote by Harry Truman, which is, someone please get me a one-handed economist, because they keep saying, on the one hand, on the other hand. And the fact of the matter is, no one agrees on this issue, let alone myself. So what do I want to talk about? I want to talk about an issue which I think matters just as much as the question of does this affect growth, which is the issue of credibility, the issue of expectations, and the issue of sentiment. Because the politics of debt relief, in my view, matters just as much as the debt itself. I have had the good fortune, the wrong word, but know quite a bit of people from college, from university, who have gone on to work in Wall Street. Some of them have big brains and they go work in investment banks. Some of them, let's be honest, are a little less smart and they become traders. And many of them become bond traders. Bond traders have what I call lizard brains. They watch their Bloomberg, they see a flash headline, and when Eurozone leaders say, we promise debt relief, and they don't deliver, they sell. And that expectation, that credibility, is lost when that is not delivered. And I think, in many respects, that has been the problem with the Greek debt discussion since the beginning. Again, I want to go back to that famous November 2012 meeting. If you go back and read the decision that was made in November 2012, it says, again, we have these targets. Greece needs to get, they didn't use 120% in the end, it has to get to 124%, again, random number, by 2020, and significantly lower than 110% by 2022. And if Greece were to achieve a primary surplus, which is basically a surplus when you don't count your debt servicing, they will be given debt relief. Now, frequently I bring this up, and I ask Eurozone leaders about this quite frequently. Didn't you promise Greek debt relief back in November 2012? They say two words. There's two words in that decision, if necessary. Now, I was there. And those two words, if necessary, were inserted to try to lend a little bit of confidence that maybe Greece won't need it. But everyone was there, knew what that statement meant. And as a matter of fact, there were three Eurogroup meetings because there was a fight between the European Commission and the IMF on this very issue. And now it's hard to realize in the current discussion, there was a time when the IMF was on the side of the Greek government in this debate. They would not sign off on the review until there was a commitment to debt relief. We are now here 3 years later, and there has been no debt relief. And I know it's very dangerous to say here in Bakianis land, but Antanas Samaras was right. He was right in that he was promised debt relief after receiving a primary surplus in 2013, and he did not get it. Now, whether this would have affected the election last year, would have affected his prospects in 2014, I'm doubtful. But when you make a commitment, you have to live up to it, or else the markets begin to doubt your credibility. Now, why do I focus so much on confidence and credibility? This has happened repeatedly. It's not just to Greece either. Just before Greece, this famous November 2012 meeting, there was another famous meeting in which something was agreed to called direct recapitalization. Now, it's kind of a fancy way to describe what actually I think is a very artful solution to what was going on in the Eurozone crisis at the time, which was the famous doom loop. Otherwise solvent countries were being brought down by insolvent banks. It wasn't necessarily the case here in Greece, but it certainly was the case in Ireland and Spain, where before the crisis they had very low debt levels, but because they had to bail out their banks, they suddenly couldn't finance themselves anymore. Easy, artful solution, I thought, was how about Ireland doesn't bail out its banks, Europe bails out its banks. Suddenly you have short-circuited that doom loop. Seemed like a good idea, and everyone agreed in June 2012 that we would do this. And as a matter of fact, again, if you go back and read that agreement, the country of Ireland is mentioned in the conclusions. Here we are, 3 years later. Ireland never received that, and the tool that was created for direct recapitalization, is so complicated that no one is ever going to use it. Again, you have promised something and you do not deliver. The markets will hold you accountable for that. I frequently give talks like this to, let's be honest, less informed crowds. And I am asked quite frequently, how did a small country on the southeastern fringe of Europe almost cause a global collapse or the end of the euro? And I have what is a gross oversimplification, but I'd like to use it because I think it's very illustrative of my point here. And my point being that it is the expectations and the credibility of the institutions in Europe that is almost as damaging to Greece that as the debt itself. Because I actually genuinely believe that the reason a small country on the southeastern fringe of Europe almost caused the collapse of the Eurozone is this very issue of credibility. And here's the story I tell students and other crowds who have followed this less frequently than this crowd has. Imagine yourself in the position of an Italian bondholder. There is this perception of bondholders that they are evil hedge fund guys sitting in New York looking to destroy the Eurozone. But actually, most government bondholders are pension funds. Little old ladies who are trying to clip their coupons and get a return, safe return on their investment for retirement. And governments are the most secure investment out there. So you are a nervous, cautious investor. And I arrived in Brussels in the middle of 2010, shortly after the first Greek bailout. And what was that bondholder told after the first Greek bailout? He was told, don't worry, Europe's going to pay you back. We have 110 billion euros we're giving to Greece to pay back the bondholders. We're setting up this big fancy thing called the EFSF with 500 billion euros that's going to pay anyone off who's afraid of a default. And I will tell you, I would go into meetings with senior officials and asked them about Greek default. And it was almost as if we were being spied upon because they would not use the word default. And actually probably we're being spied upon now that we know, probably the NSA. But at the time they didn't know that. The word default could not be mentioned even in an off-the-record conversation.
Peter, even you are running out of time.
I am wrapping up. This is my last story. Go from that event in which bondholders were told, don't worry, you will be made whole, to 6 months later. In the French seaside town of Deauville, Angela Merkel and Nicolas Sarkozy said to that bondholder, remember I told you you'd be made whole? I've changed my mind. You'll be made whole now, but in 2013 we're setting up this new system where we're going to start forcing losses upon you. Well, if you're a bondholder, what do? The credibility of the people who just told you don't worry about it has been undermined. Sell, 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 sell. I want a safe investment. Get me out of here. What happens? Ireland and Portugal suddenly cannot finance themselves. Let's flash forward another 6 months. These same group of leaders come together and say, ah, did I tell you you're going to have defaults in 2013? I lied to you. You're going to have defaults now. But don't worry, they're small little defaults. It's 21% net present value. You know, it's in the future. Don't worry about it. What is the reaction to that? Sell, 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 sell. Spain and Italy almost fall off the cliff. 6 months later, did I say small, little 21% net present value? No, I lied to you again. It's big, swathing, 51% face value haircuts. I've been lied to four times. Why would I invest in Eurozone bonds? The issue of credibility on debt relief is critical to me. And that is why I still, to this day, do not understand why 3 years after that November 2012 decision was made, that successive governments have not been given that. That is cowardice, and that is political cowardice, and that is deceiving the markets. And until the confidence returns and that expectation is lived up to, the markets will continue to act against Greece. Thank you. Thank you.